Allowing something bigger than your problems to define you, bigger than your circumstances to define you. You are in a bigger arena than that. And you discover then that God has called you to a higher calling. We do not want to let ourselves be defined by lower things, but rather to be defined by the ultimate. And when that occurs then, we can choose the way of joy. I can't choose to be strong, but I can choose to be joyful. And when I'm willing to do that, I believe strength can follow.
Ken, when I read that, it looks to me like he's looking to the future. Mm-hmm. He's looking for the day of calamity for those that are going to invade.
He anticipates the day of calamity.
Yeah,
and he says, in spite of that, I'm going to hope in you. Because he looks beyond that day of calamity as well. Yeah,
he's looking beyond that mm-hmm. day to the day when they will be destroyed. So isn't his joy really in the destruction of their enemies?
No, not his joy is not in this context in the destruction of his enemies, because he's saying that no matter what happens to us, nevertheless, I'm going to rejoice. I think that when we look at the prophets, we see that there's always a message of condemnation, and then there's a message of consolation. The condemnation is because of the wickedness of the people, but the consolation is because of the promise that God, in spite of our wickedness, though he brings judgment, will ultimately keep covenant, and there is a future for us. And I think that what gives consolation is the ultimate perspective of future. It would give me little pleasure to see that my enemy is destroyed. At the end of the day, the real pleasure, the real joy is going to be found in God's eternal promises, you see. And that's why in the book of Hebrews, you see a men and women of faith. If you go to Hebrews 11, and we've looked at this, but when I see these people, I find they have this thing in common. They're desiring something more than this world can sustain. In verse 16, they desire a better country, that is a heavenly one. And in verse 13, all these died in faith without receiving the promises, but having seen them and having welcomed them from a distance and having confessed that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. So what I see here then is the understanding that the one who comes to God, go back earlier in that chapter, in chapter 11, verse 6, must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him. And if I look to him for the long term and recognize that ultimately all will be well and he will turn all around, I think that's a perspective that I can embrace in the midst of adversity. I can choose the way of joy is what I'm suggesting. And I believe then that choosing the way of joy is choosing the way of trust. When I trust him enough to believe that in spite of this, you will bring me to the other side. And furthermore, I look back at my own journey, and there have been very hard spots in my life, and he's brought me through those. And I can believe that if his promises are sure, that he will bring me safely to the other side. It's not a promise that life will be easy. In fact, we're pretty well assured that in this world you will have tribulation. But you can take courage, you can take joy, because I have overcome the world. We're in a larger story than that which world can provide for us. And I think that's very significant for us. So I want to say that whatever is going on in your life, I mentioned before that this morning I wake up and I'm in great pain. I'm still in great pain because my eyes have gotten messed up and I can barely think and read and so forth. Yet I decided to choose the way of joy. You got a purpose for this. I don't know what it is. I'm not happy about it. I don't enjoy it. But I found myself, this is the grace of God, to be honest with you, saying that you got a purpose in this. And I can look beyond that, and you will use even this. Even the small things, even the small hassles can be things that God can use in redemptive ways. Whatever that might be, you don't know what it looks like. Any thoughts before I go any further on that? Back there, yes.
I'm wrestling with this notion of...
Speak up, Dean.
I'm wrestling with the notion of being able to choose joy. Because my experience has
gone a number of years in trying to kind of be joyful. Scripture says I should be joyful, and I was never able to conjure it up.
Because you're trying to conjure up a feeling, not an attitude. That's the huge difference. You cannot conjure up joy if you define it as a feeling. You can't make yourself feel happy. Oh, boy, I'm happy all the day. Like one of these silly songs that, that we used to sing when I was a kid. Now I am happy all the day. It's not so simple as that. But you can choose an attitude, and that's different, you see. That has to do with my will and not with my emotions. I know you, Robert, you're going to... And that I think, is a huge difference. So do I? What is my perspective? You can look at it this way. It relates to my perspective. Is this something that God can use redemptively or not? Do I feel good about it? No, I don't. I don't enjoy the thing happening. Nobody enjoys alienation, broken relationship. Nobody enjoys physical pain and adversity, and nobody enjoys financial uncertainty. We're not trivializing those things at all. We live in a difficult world. But I do believe that we can choose a perspective, and that is where your power of will comes in. I get to choose this perspective whether I will take the way of trust and hope or whether I'm going to take the way of allowing my emotions to produce despair and uncertainty. That's, I think, a settled disposition.
Couldn't joy be described as confidence that no matter the circumstance that you're going to be taken care of?
I think that's a good way to describe it. You just describe it as confidence that no matter what the circumstances, you're going to be taken care of. And that enables you to transcend the circumstances. That's a very good way of describing it. I think it's very good. Yes, Bruce. I think it's Bruce there. I can hardly see.
Stand up, Bruce.
Well, one thing good about joy is that it doesn't come from us. It's the Holy Spirit in us.
Yes.
It's the release.
It's the release.
It's the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace. And so joy comes from Him in us, lived out through us.
Yes.
And so it's not something I try to conjure up or manufacture, and even it's an attitude that's the release of the Spirit.
Yeah. It's a combination, I think. I see it as a divine-human synergy. I think on the one perspective, my choice of trust is an attitude that I embrace, but that also works together with the release of the Spirit in my life. And clearly then, the fruit of the Spirit, what are they? Love. What's the second one?
Joy
and peace. Stop there. If there were only three fruits of the Spirit, it would be enough. Wouldn't you agree? Frankly, that's what people really want. They think they want things, possession and happiness and so forth. What they want is love and joy and peace. And that is a product of the Spirit of God. So what I mean by this divine-human synergy, and Bruce is bringing in the other dimension, is that the Spirit of God gives us the power to embrace love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, that we ourselves could not manufacture. Nevertheless, He invites us to be obedient and to embrace a biblical perspective and to put our hope and our trust in Him. I see them both. I see it as both a divine and a human process. It won't just come upon us. We must, in fact, invite the Spirit to be released in us, to trust in Him, and to choose the way then of asking the Spirit, of abiding in the Spirit. Yes, David?
It's very much like love itself. Joy is a choice, an attitude. Love is very often an attitude as well. Even those we love the most, we don't always like what they're doing,
yep.
Like what they're saying, and yet we choose to love them.
Yeah, and that. Yes, because that's why I say that it's very good that Jesus commanded us to love one another, not to like one another. Because there's an enormous difference between the two. Like is an emotion or a feeling. And frankly, there are times when you don't like somebody. But you can choose the way of love. Again, love really is, in a similar manner, it's like joy insofar as it's more of a choice. But I can choose the way of love even when the feelings aren't present. Take peace as the other one. Love, joy, and peace. Peace in a similar way is a choice. It's not, if it's just in the feeling, you're not going to just be able to conjure up this peace. But it's the fruit of the Spirit in our lives, and it's also a choice to choose the way of